climbs off all by itself. It just, it does it itself. Okay?
Yeah, you're right there with me
Every time I open the hangar door to go flying, I realize that I'm one of the lucky guys doing something that I dreamt of as a kid.
May 12, 1944. Allied bombers reach deep into Germany to attack synthetic oil plants critical to German military forces. The 56th Fighter Group, known as Zemke's Wolfpack, is the deadliest fighter group in the 8th Air Force. On May 12th, the Wolfpack applies new and aggressive tactics to protect Allied bombers over Germany. On that day, Shorty Rankin of the 56th Fighter Group becomes the first P-47 pilot in Europe to score 5 victories in a single mission. Gunther Rall commanded a Luftwaffe squadron at age 22. By 1944, he is one of the war's highest scoring aces. On May 12, 1944, Allied bombers score a decisive blow against Germany's synthetic oil production. Nazi armaments minister Albert Speer later calls it the day Germany lost the war. I'm Gary Sinise, and this is Missions That Changed the War. June 1941. The war in Europe is 2 years old. Much of the continent lies under the Nazi heel. America has not yet entered the war. Hub Zemke is in Russia, assigned to teach Russian pilots to fly American Lend-Lease P-40 fighter planes. Shorty Rankin has just joined the U.S. Army Air Corps as a musician. Gunther Rall's squadron, now flying the new ME-109F model, is assigned to an airfield near the oil refineries at Ploiești, Romania. On June 22, 1941, without warning, Hitler launches Operation Barbarossa, the invasion of the Soviet Union. More than 4.5 million Axis troops sweep into the USSR along an 1,800-mile front, from Finland to the Black Sea. It is a turning point in the war in Europe. Germany's Adolf Hitler believed that his nation was overcrowded, that the Germans needed more land to settle, to provide natural resources like metals and oil, and to feed the population. He envisioned the Ukraine as a German colony where his countrymen would live on large, well-kept, irrigated farms. In August 1939, Germany and Russia signed a non-aggression pact, but Hitler and Russian dictator Joseph Stalin deeply distrusted each other. Stalin expected a German invasion despite Hitler's assurances of peace. Stalin had reasoned that Hitler's attack would come in the summer of 1942, only after Germany had conquered England and France. But Germany desperately needed the oil, tin, grain, and other resources of the Ukraine. By the end of 1940, the Wehrmacht High Command was already preparing for an invasion of the Soviet Union to begin the following May. Its code name, Operation Barbarossa. Moscow, Hitler said, would be the key. take the capital city, and the Soviet Union would fall. Unaware of Hitler's secret plans, Gunther Rall and the pilots of his JG-52 were shocked by the news of the invasion of Russia.
I came back from Greek Island. This was a lousy battle. We came back to Romania, to Misil. It's a little gypsy village at the foot of the Carpathians. And we were there a couple of days and got new airplane, and the 104, the 109F. And during that time, there was build up and hit forces from the army. I said, what's going on? To an officer, you know, we go to Russia. And we were shocked. Are they crazy? The war is not finished in the West. No, we start a two-front war in the Russia. So we were set up, no doubt. But there's not very much danger. You know, you put in action and you do your job.
The invasion force included 3 million men and 3,400 tanks. The Russians, caught unprepared, were overrun and pushed east. On the first day of the invasion, the Luftwaffe destroyed 1,498 Soviet aircraft on the ground. Another 322 were shot down by German fighters or by German anti-aircraft artillery. In the 1930s, Russia was a world leader in the design of military aircraft, including long-range heavy bombers and fighter aircraft like the Polikarpov I-16, the world's first cantilever wing monoplane fighter with retractable landing gear, introduced in 1933. But Stalin imagined plots and traitors everywhere. In his purges of the 1930s, millions of Russians were arrested, imprisoned, and shot for the slightest hint of disloyalty.
The Russian Air Force was absolutely, totally demoralized because Stalin had purged the leadership of the Soviet armed forces. He killed off about 70% of their top leaders from colonels on up. And the result was that not only were the people afraid of being purged and killed, they were afraid to even have a taxi accident. So training standards were very low. So for the initial months of the war, the Russians were flying essentially obsolete airplanes, no tactics, no training, and was a killing ground for the Germans.
Where in Russia, this was estranged. When we came into Russia first, we hit a not very well trained air force with not very compatible equipment, you know, the Rata E-16, he flew it already in Spain on the 153, and they didn't have tactics in the air, and they lost tremendous number. But they took the lessons. And it took time, and the Russians switched then to the MiG, LAK, and Yak aircraft, modern aircraft, comparable with ours, exactly. And they changed the tactics. Also, it came to the full ship formation. So they changed very quickly, but at the beginning they were not, that equivalent with us.
Within 6 days, the Germans had captured Minsk, the capital of Bielorussia. As the Wehrmacht swept across the Ukraine in late June, Gunther Rall's squadron moved to Mamaia in eastern Romania, near the Romanian oil shipping port of Constanza on the Black Sea. At Mamaia, we are greeted by a large expanse of meadow and one dilapidated hangar. No refueling facilities, a single telephone, no radar units anywhere. The commander of Constanza's flak defenses is relieved to see us. He puts great hope in us, but without proper infrastructure, we too are almost helpless.
I will tell you, this is different. And even the Air Force didn't understand that. They didn't care. I give you an example. Take a wing in France, stationed 3-4 years, flying against England. The air battle is everywhere very serious. But when they land, they have their white beds, they have their shower room, they have this officer's club. This is tremendous. We lived in tents from April to September. Then we are looking for bunkers or kolchose, you know, the lost kolchoses. You have a complete different thing. You cannot go somewhere or the bus. You this has a psychological impact on you. This is different. This is a matter of the leader of that unit, that he keeps his soldiers, in good position mentally. You live with your guys like in a family, you know. But it was not that easy.
As the German lines move eastward, their supply lines grow longer and more fragile. On July 3rd, Stalin declares a scorched earth policy to deny the Germans any chance of living off the land. Russian partisans fighting behind German battle lines attack German supply columns and supply dumps. The German response is ruthless.
But the Pfadfinder fand ich nicht.
Security in these areas will be sufficient only if all resistance is punished, not by legal prosecution of the guilty, but by the spreading of such terror by the occupying power as is appropriate to eradicate every inclination to resist among the population. The faintest protest or disobedience should be met with ruthless reprisals. Political officers and leaders are to be liquidated. In Romania, Gunther Rall's JG-52 was busy through June and July 1941. By the month's end, the oil port of Constanza had been attacked by a total of 285 Soviet bombers in 38 separate raids. Our group succeeds in shooting down 44 enemy machines without the enemy inflicting serious damage to the oil terminal. After that, the Russians cease their raids almost entirely. In August, JG-52 moves north into the Ukraine. From the small town of Bylyazyrkov, Gunther's Staffel escorts Stuka dive bombers to nearby Kiev. Opposing them are mostly obsolete Russian fighter planes left over from the Spanish Civil War.
Was nun im Sommer 1938?
Technically and tactically, the Russian fighter arm at this time is years behind the Germans, but its pilots display admirable fighting spirit. They usually fly in a completely disorganized manner, whole gaggles of them twisting and turning. Time and again, we are able to slice through these and achieve quick kills, but our opponents are learning fast. On a sortie in mid-August, Rall is flying as wingman for a new replacement pilot. They attack a pair of Russian fighters from behind. At this instant, there is a tremendous bang behind my cockpit. The whole aircraft seems to explode. I can hear and feel shots hitting the back of my seat. Something crashes into my skull. Blood trickles from under my flying helmet. A headshot. I've been hit. Rall nurses his ME-109 to a forward airfield and learns that an oxygen cylinder exploding behind the cockpit had torn loose from the armor plating behind his head. The jagged armor gave him an ugly but superficial scalp wound. His ME-109 is a total loss. He is soon back in the air, his JG-52 flying two, three, sometimes four missions a day, supporting the ground troops around Kiev. The skies above the Ukrainian capital are full of enemy fighters from early morning until late evening. And the score for JG-52 begins to rise rapidly. On August 4th, it totals 20 victories. Usually, it is between 5 and 10. Shot down in late September, Rall bellies in a forest clearing and makes his way back to the German lines. Others were not so lucky. German pilots who crash land behind Russian lines are often tortured and killed by their captors. On this front, there was no mercy, no chivalry, no Geneva Convention. September 1941. Plans for a lightning conquest of Russia are beginning to unravel. Victory is eluding the Germans at Kiev and Leningrad, and the infamous Russian mud is delaying the advance on Moscow. Hitler's plan called for rapid encirclement and destruction of the Red Army, but the Russians have fallen back, buying time in exchange for territory. The men of JG-52 operate out of 9 different fields in September alone. In late September, the group moves to Poltava, 200 miles further east.
In Germany, there was a newspaper, Völkischer Beobachter. And the editor, the guy of this, a high-ranking Nazi guy, headlines, "When the first snow falls, it's all over." The first snowfall fell. I was in Poltava in a tent. And then we got run down to minus 30 degrees temperature. Unprepared, even for the mechanics, they had no gloves, and it was horrible. It took a time to recover. No doubt, we got it, but it took time. And this was very, very bad.
All of a sudden, winter is upon us. Yesterday, the autumn sun warmed us with a balmy 18 degrees. Today, a cold wind whistles through every crack in the mess tent, and we are freezing at minus 15 centigrade. The meadow we operate from hardens into a thin sheet of ice. We are in no way equipped for such weather. The mechanics, least of all, who, dressed in their thin, inadequate overalls, strive to keep serviceable the machines parked out in the open, fully exposed to the elements. Our fighting strength is slowly but surely being whittled away. In the last 3 months, experienced men have been lost, leaving behind gaps that cannot be filled by inexperienced replacement pilots. If a pilot is fit for operations, he spends 2 or 3 hours in the air every day against a numerically superior enemy. At night, our airfield is bombed regularly. We are weakened by poor food and diarrhea, plagued by lice, worn down by lack of hygiene.
You know, we did our duty. We were not enthusiastic about the war in Russia. We lived under very poor conditions, and we were really challenged. It was cold, it was lousy, we were in tents, we had air battles almost every day, you know, and this was a hard time.
October 1941. The German army is approaching Moscow, Hitler's primary objective. But the Russians halt the Germans a few miles from the city. While the standoff continues into November, Gunther Rall's JG-52 is still fighting near Kiev. 28 November 1941 was an icily cold day. In the air, everything around us fades into a milky haze, lacking all lines and contours. We spot 2 radars and climb at full throttle to a position above and behind them. The Russian is now filling the ring of my reflector sight, and he still doesn't suspect a thing. Edge in closer. Lift the nose a little. Now, my tracer bullets strike the fuselage and wing of my opponent. And then he explodes in a brilliant fireball. I am completely blinded. For 3 or 4 seconds, I have to concentrate entirely on keeping my Messerschmitt under control. Then, suddenly, there is a crashing in front of me, and bits of cowling fly past me. I've been hit.
He shot my engine off, out. And I was about 300 meters high, and the glide angle, so I went down, bellied in the snow, but the speed was too high, and I jumped up again. Now I was stalling just above this ditch. So I had to push it down again, otherwise, and went down, and then the wall came, and the big crash, and it was out. The engine flew 40 meters through the air, and the wings came off, and I was down at the bottom of that, completely rotten.
Unconscious and bleeding from a wound that had peeled back his scalp, Rall was cut from his cockpit by a German panzer crew and taken to a nearby field hospital. His scalp was stitched up, but the doctor could do little about the terrible back pain from the crash. After 3 weeks without X-ray or treatment, he was flown to Hungary.
Hendrik, the senior officer, he fixed that I came to with a U-52 to Bucharest, to a normal hospital. And there, I was alerted. I came up to the X-ray, and then he came to my bed, the doctor. And I said, Herr Oberlein, and I was a first lieutenant at that time, forget flying, that's out. You broke your back 3 times. And then I stopped and said, Doctor, I will fly again.
In the spring of 1941, the United States Congress passed the Lend-Lease Act, which authorized the president to sell, lease, or give war materials to allied nations. The Lend-Lease Act ended America's pretense of neutrality and led directly to German submarine attacks on U.S. merchant ships. But between 1941 and 1943, when America's allies did most of the fighting, Lend-Lease was essential to the war effort and to the Allies' eventual victory. In 1941, Hub Zemke and his longtime friend John Allison were sent to England to help the British assemble, test, and train an American-built Curtiss P-40 Tomahawks that Britain purchased under Lend-Lease. Zemke and Allison also studied the Royal Air Force's organization, training, and equipment. Zemke was especially impressed by the RAF's early warning radar system and by its air control system, which kept track of all RAF fighters and bombers in the air. He flew RAF Hurricanes and Spitfires, studied reports on German fighters, and found them all superior to anything America was producing. Observing RAF operations in 1941, Zemke and Allison realized that the U.S. Army Air Corps was totally unprepared for combat. At high altitudes, the Curtiss P-40 was outmatched by British and German fighters. The RAF assigned its P-40s to low-altitude roles. When Hitler invaded the Soviet Union, the Russians desperately needed war materials, including modern aircraft. The RAF was only too happy to send nearly 200 of its P-40s to Russia. Zemke, Allison, and a few RAF mechanics were sent to Russia in August 1941 to help assemble the P-40s and to teach the Russians to fly them. The Russian pilots learned quickly, and Zemke was impressed by their skill and their fighting spirit.
Lend-Lease was doubly important. One, it showed them that we were committed, and it showed the Russian population that we were committed. And Lend-Lease was not only P-39s and P-40s, it was acres and acres of Dodge trucks and food and supplies that got down to the population because everybody was engaged in the war effort. So tremendously important in terms of the effect on the Russian public.
On December 7th, 1941, the Japanese attacked the U.S. naval base at Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. 4 days later, Germany and Italy declared war on the United States. America was officially at war. In Moscow, Zemke and Allison could hear the artillery battle as the Germans approached the Russian capital. Eager to get home and get into the fight, Zemke made his way south to Tehran, then to Egypt, Brazil, Puerto Rico, and finally the U.S. after a journey of 4 months. Zemke was promoted to captain and given his first command, the new 89th Fighter Squadron. 2 weeks later, he was given command of the 56th Fighter Group and was soon a lieutenant colonel. Promotions came fast in wartime. The 56th was a unique command. Not only did Zemke have to turn fresh flight school graduates into effective fighter pilots, he also had to test and evaluate a radically new fighter design, the Republic P-47 Thunderbolt.
Well, P-47 was immensely important, not only in quantity, but ultimately in quality. When it rolled out, the original model was troublesome. It didn't have the performance that they wanted, but it was going to be available. The Republic then had the manufacturing capability. We ordered a lot of them, and we knew that it was powered by this great engine, this Pratt & Whitney R2800 engine that was going to be a lead engine in the war. And over time, it was improved. It was improved with a better propeller, improved with a better turbo supercharger system, improved with better canopy. It had external fuel tanks applied to it. It became a very, very effective weapon. If you'd like to provoke an argument, just tell a P-47 pilot that the P-51 is a better airplane, and you'll get a good argument.
Overall, Zemke was not impressed with the P-47. In his autobiography, he wrote, "The pilots were all eager young fellows who thought the Thunderbolt was a terrific fighter, simply because they had flown nothing else." November 1942. The U.S. Army invades North Africa in Operation Torch. U.S. Marines are fighting the Japanese on the Pacific island of Guadalcanal. The savage battle, begun in August, will rage on until the end of the year. The battle for Stalingrad that began in September grinds on into the second brutal winter of the German invasion. The Soviets launch a major counteroffensive at Stalingrad, and the Germans fall back to avoid encirclement. But Hitler orders the army to stand its ground. On Thanksgiving Day, 1942, the 56th Fighter Group received orders transferring them to England. Arriving in January 43, they began a long period of further training in radio work, tactics, RAF protocols, and instrument flying. Zemke knew that his pilots had a lot to learn. His job as commander was to foster and encourage the aggressiveness that would make them killers while imposing the discipline and the unit cohesion that would keep them alive in combat.
The fighter pilots they begin to get 20, 21 years old, highly spirited, 2 years of college, 3 years of college, the cream of the crop physically, mentally, cocksure of themselves, egocentric as hell, and being fighter pilots on top of that, thought they walked on water and talked to God. Instituting discipline among this group of people, building cohesion, and training them was a first-class task.
The United States, and to use the term again, was an OJT Air Force. We were learning to fly and to fight and to build airplanes and to ship them overseas and to maintain them all at the same time. And guys who would have been a lieutenant for 8 years suddenly found themselves being captains and majors and colonels within a matter of months. And for the most part, did a terrific job. They accepted their responsibilities and worked.
Bad luck haunted Zemke and the 56th Fighter Group in their first months in England. Missions were scrubbed by mechanical problems or fouled up by inexperience. In its first 90 days in combat, the 56th shot down only two planes, both RAF Spitfires, and lost two P-47s. Finally, on June 11th, Captain Walter Cook shot down a Focke-Wulf 190 for the unit's first confirmed kill. More victories followed quickly. By the fall of 1943, under Zemke's tough but fair leadership, the 56th had become one of the most effective fighter groups in the 8th Air Force.
I think the fairest thing to say is that not every ace is a commander. For an ace to do that, it's very difficult. Aces don't want to subordinate themselves to anything but getting out and killing airplanes. I mean, when you get an ace who can not only be an ace, but lead a squadron and create a squadron of aces, then you have a pearl without price.
Shorty Rankin joined the 56th Fighter Group as a replacement pilot in August of 1943. He scored 10 victories with Zemke's Wolfpack. Later, during the Cold War, Rankin commanded 6 fighter jet squadrons.
Zemke's Wolfpack was so successful because of Hub Zemke and his leadership and what he instilled in the pilots and made them aggressive to carry on to get the job done.
Shorty Rankin was drafted in March 1941. A talented musician, he spent more than a year as a member of an army band before applying for flight training.
I want to tell you how I became a fighter pilot. And I was in advanced flying school. My instructor said, we're going to meet at a certain altitude. We're going to do a 180 away from each other, fly for 2 minutes, and then come back head on and rat race and see who can get on the other's tail. Well, I was a young aviation cadet, but I was in advanced flying school, and all along I've been told the pilot who has the height advantage has the advantage. So as I was climbing away, when I left, I was climbing the whole time, and I was climbing on the way back, so I had him locked cold. I got on his tail, there's no way he'd get away from me. And that's the reason I was selected to be a fighter pilot, because I whipped his butt. That's how it happened. There was 400 in my pilot class. Only 60 of us got fighters. So I was very lucky. The rest of them had to go to be co-pilots in 17 and 24.
After completing flight training, Rankin was sent to England to Shrewsbury, a replacement center for 8th Air Force fighter groups.
They were transitioning RAF pilots, U.S. pilots, who had been flying for the RAF, giving them transition into P-47s. Well, those of us coming from the States, we had about 130 hours in the airplane. And then finally they started orders to go to fighter groups. And fortunately for me and 10 others, we got to 56. If you did what they told you, you had a good chance of completing the war. And of 11 of us, 10 of us did. And 2 of us became aces.
In early January 1942, Gunther Rall is put aboard a hospital train and transferred to Vienna, encased in a full body cast that leaves him mostly helpless. In Vienna, he is under the care of a pretty, petite female ward doctor. The ward doctor, Hertha Schoen, is a young Viennese, slightly older than myself, friendly, who makes every effort from the start to ensure that my recovery progresses smoothly, and moreover, is always a delight to see. When Rall's father dies a few weeks later of a burst appendix, it is Dr. Schoen who brings the news to Rall's bedside.
Lasse auftanken und kehre mit dem letzten.
Dr. Schoen fully understands that I now need someone to talk to. She stays with me for a long time this evening. She will remain by my side for 43 years. On the Eastern Front, temperatures of minus 54 Fahrenheit have brought most of the fighting to a halt. But while the Germans freeze and run short of supplies, Russian fighting men and equipment pour into the Soviet lines from the east. In December 1941, the Germans launch a new push to take Moscow, but the Russians hold, then counterattack. By January 1942, the Red Army has pushed the invaders back 200 miles to the west. The Soviets' success sends a message to the world. The German war machine and blitzkrieg are not unstoppable. Rall's broken back heals slowly, and his doctors are making no promises. But after 5 long months, the cast comes off and Rall begins rebuilding his strength. In mid-May, nearly 6 months after he was shot down, Rall climbs carefully into a trainer aircraft for some aerobatic maneuvers. It's a successful flight.
Nur 5 Jahre nach.
My back is holding up. It hardly hurts at all. Somewhat hesitantly, Hertha rises from her chair and comes to stand alongside the Jungmeister while I'm undoing my harness. Her eyes, her facial expression reflect conflicting emotion, a mix of relief and sadness. In this moment, I realize that my life no longer belongs to me alone. I've got to return to my crowd, I say as I take her hand in mine. But Hertha, I'm coming back. By early summer 1942, the Germans still have not captured Leningrad or Sevastopol, two of their major war aims. In May, they defeat and capture nearly 500,000 Russian soldiers, but the Russians can afford even these grim losses. In less than a year, the Germans have lost 1 million men on the Eastern Front, a third of the Eastern armies. Of the goals Hitler set for Operation Barbarossa, not a single one has been met. The Soviets continue to fall back as the Germans push deeper into Russia, trying to encircle an enemy that is no longer there. This deadly cat and mouse game is bleeding the Germans, exhausting their equipment, supplies, and men. But Hitler sees only German victories. In July 1942, Hitler divides Army Group South, sending half of that force toward the Crimea to capture the oil fields. The other half, 250,000 men under General Friedrich Paulus, move toward Stalingrad. The supply situation is now critical for the Germans. Paulus's army runs out of fuel in late July and again in mid-August. German tanks are stalled, only 35 miles from Stalingrad. Gunther Rall reaches his old unit, JG-52, on 28 July 1942. For the next month, they are constantly moving. 200,000 German troops are lost on the Eastern Front in August 1942 alone. Never before has there been so many casualties in so short a time. True, over the same period, the Wehrmacht captured 625,000 prisoners. But the Red Army is able not merely to make good on these losses. It is constantly adding to to the numbers of its frontline units. In September 1942, the German army reaches the center of Stalingrad. Heavy fighting continues in the ruined city. In the south, the farther the Germans advance, the harder the Red Army resists. Hitler now knows he cannot capture the huge oil refineries and oil tanks at Grozny. He orders their destruction. In early October, Rall's JG-52 is ordered south to escort the bombers. During a fighter sweep on 22 October, Rall downs three Russian aircraft in 4 minutes, with a total of 100 aerial victories. He is awarded the oak leaves to the Knight's Cross, to be presented by the Führer himself at the Wolf's Lair, Hitler's mountain retreat.
There was, at that time, there was Truschel Steinhoff was with me, and some others, five, six. And this always, Hitler gave the order, and then we are sitting around the fireplace, and he asked, where are you coming from, where are you coming from? And then he developed his plans and ideas to us. At that time, Hitler had a very clear, you could say what it was with his target, but he had a clear plan, whether you like it or not, but because this means watering the desert in Ukraine, you know, and settling farmers in their things. And never think, this lasted always 1 hour. And in the middle, I interrupted him. Steinhoff said, are you crazy? And I said, mein Führer, how long is this war in Russia going to last? The reason was, you know, these headlines, you know, that when the first snow falls, it's all over. And I asked these questions, Hitler stopped. And he said, first time he addressed me, Rall, I don't know. The great leader doesn't know.
Soon after Rall's meeting with Hitler, Gunther and Hertha are married in Vienna. In November, Rall reports back to his unit. JG-52 was already the most successful fighter group in the Luftwaffe, and its pilots continued to rack up victories. But they cannot change the outcome. All along the Eastern Front, the Germans are being pushed back. In July 1943, British and American troops invaded Sicily. In the Ukraine, the Germans suffered a crucial defeat at the Battle of Kursk, the largest and bloodiest tank battle in the history of land warfare. Rall's JG-52 was engaged in an equally savage air battle in the skies over Kursk. When the battle began, the Russians had half again as many aircraft over the battle area as the Germans. By the battle's end, despite huge losses, the Russians had three times the number of German fighters.
There was a time when I said to my wife, after Kursk, Harry, the war is lost. We didn't believe anymore that the victory is lost. We just waited what's going on, maybe diplomatic activities or what else.
In September 1943, with 200 victories, Rall was awarded the swords to the Knight's Cross. He traveled to Prussia again to receive the award directly from Hitler at the Wolf's Lair retreat.
And Hitler, and he talked to us, not any more facts, settling farmers, watering, and so forth. No. Very dark suit, but strip on the horizon. Those bullshit, you know. Mere mystic. Mystic.
I know I didn't want to fly the Pacific. I don't like water. So I was real pleased when I got assigned to Europe. And I was thrilled when I went to join the 56th Fighter Group and found out what they were all about.